Hey all, good afternoon. Yeah, I had to wait till this afternoon. I'm trying something new. Plus, I did have a lot of trouble for 2 days there with YouTube. I don't know what the deal was. To give you an idea, earlier in the day, yesterday or the day before, I was trying to upload a video for my speech communication class. And it said 47 minutes. I'm like, wait a minute, this is only like 15 minutes long. 47 minutes left to upload it. I said, this is way too long. Last night, I ended up doing it. It still took 3 minutes, which I thought was a little longer than normal, but at least it got through. So hopefully what we'll do today will go through. Doing something a little different. We're in my living room today, and we're talking about my favorite chapter, and that, of course, is television. I'm just a big television junkie, all the way back to the history of TV, to where we are today, which is one of the most fascinating places I think we could be when talking about intro to mass media or mass media communication. This course, television, what can you say? It's just dynamic. There is no distinction anymore, it seems, between like what a broadcast network or a cable network, because now, as I was rewatching the other day, Ricky Gervais, when he last hosted the Golden Globe Awards, he says everybody's on Netflix. Whether it's, you know, what people would refer to as like TV shows or movies or whatever it is, it's just like, these streaming services now just provide everything. So it's really the distinction. And when you look at these award shows, when I see like the Emmy Award, now the Emmy Awards originally were for television. And it was just strictly for the networks. And that, of course, would be NBC, ABC, CBS, and Fox. And then, of course, they had to start adding in some of the cable, because some of the cable TV stations, when they started to produce their own programming, it was really good. And then, of course, HBO. You know, when you had shows, you know, I don't want to go all the way back to The Sopranos, because there were a lot of shows even before The Sopranos. Shows that were really good, Showtime, Cinemax, they were all producing great programs that had to be recognized. And so they would also be thrown into the Emmy Awards. But now, when you throw things in like Netflix and what they produce, I mean, Orange is the New Black, and of course, many of the other shows that they've produced with some of the others. I mean, Hulu and Amazon. I know the last, what was the? The Golden Globes. Ricky Gervais had mentioned about that new show with, what's her name from Friends? Jennifer Aniston. And that's, of course, on Amazon. That's an Amazon Prime original program. So it's really weird. It's dynamic. It's crazy, and it's really hard to keep up with. So, especially when you think back to the way it all started. Now, in the 1930s, we had this guy right here. See that young fella? That's a guy by the name of Philo Farnsworth. Now, what Philo did is Philo came up with that little piece that he's holding in his hand. That's called the image dissector. See, what he did is he kind of took an old tube that you would use like in a regular camera to take still photos. And he took that tube and he put it to electricity, harnessing electronic energy. And he would point it. And he would take that image and then it would be transformed electronically through these cables into what was a screen, that little round screen that he has there. And it wasn't a still photo. You would actually see what was going on as it was happening. So somebody could be like, one, two, three, four, and that's what you would see on the screen. Well, there are a lot of controversies going on about how it eventually ended up where it did. Because Philo, although he created the image dissector, wasn't the founder of television. Some say there was some nefarious things going on, and well, let's be honest, when you've got the money, you've got the money. And sure enough, who ends up introducing television to America and the world? You got it. David Sarnoff, the president and owner of NBC Radio, the largest radio network in the world. He started into television in the early 1930s. And why not? He had the money. He had the overhead. You know, at the time that he started dabbling into television, realizing, again, that visual medium is so powerful, is that He wanted television, and he had, oh God, he had two, NBC Red and NBC Blue, two national radio networks going at the same time, making buku bucks. So, and as a matter of fact, one of his NBC radios would end up becoming ABC Radio. So he had the overhead. This guy just had buku bucks. So he ends up getting it. And he introduces television to the world. In 1939, at the New York World's Fair, over in Queens, okay? Some of you know where it is. If you ever go to Citi Field, it's right over there. They had the New York World's Fair in 1939 and in 1964, right there in Flushing Meadows. Here, right in front of the RCA Pavilion, in 1939, that's David Sarnoff. As you can see, he's in RCA. And then just over to his right there, you can see the guy sitting, and he's sitting with NBC Radio. So, of course, Sarnoff is the creator and owner of all this crap. And he's introducing television, and it was great. Because, I mean, people already were flocking to the movies. And by 1939, movies were extremely popular. And it wasn't a mistake, even, you know, at this point, where you went to the movies 3-4 times a week. Movie theaters, and we'll talk more about this in the movies chapter after the midterm. But you would go to the movies 3-4 times a week. So the visual medium was there. You know, people like Sarnoff knew that we wanted, and it's been like that since the dawn of time. Since the dawn of time, people have loved to be visually entertained. Don't think so? Look at the ancient Greeks. Those ancient Greek theaters. Where did they come from? Shakespeare, in the 1500s, writing his plays for those theaters out there in England. We love to be visually entertained. That's why there are stadiums. Okay, we love to sit and watch football or baseball or whatever professional sport that we like. The arenas, everything. We love concerts. We love to be visually entertained. And Sarnoff knew that. And so when television came along, he jumped at it. Okay, he really jumped on top of it. And it was an amazing thing to see. It was the single biggest talked about attraction at the 1939's World's Fair. So when the World's Fair was going to be over at the end of the summer, Sarnoff was ready to go ahead and start to expand television. One thing happened, though, is that before the summer ended, on September 1st, 1939, some of my history buffs know exactly what that date is. September 1st, 1939 is when Germany invaded Poland. 2 days later, England and France declared war on Germany. World War II has now begun. And even though the United States wasn't in the war yet, and wouldn't be for another 2.5 years, we knew eventually we would be. So a lot of technology and a lot of advance, a lot of things went into going into the war effort. Until eventually in 1941, with the attack at Pearl Harbor, we then enter. Even though, and here's the, a lot of people don't really realize this, is that even though the Japanese attacked us at Pearl Harbor, we ended up putting a lot of focus on fighting Hitler in Germany. I mean, Hitler did declare war on us the day after Pearl Harbor, but we knew that he was the real, you know, the Japanese we were gonna take care of, but we really needed to do something about Hitler. So you've got all these efforts going into World War II. And Sarnoff, of course, was at the lead of that with technology. Well, soon as the war ends in 1945, he sends all his people back into television. So now in 1948, you see the birth of two of the three major television networks that still exist today. And that, of course, is the NBC television network. Hey, David Sarnoff. And his rival over at CBS Radio, the CBS television network, which was run by a guy by the name of William S. Paley. All right? And Paley was also a very, very, very powerful guy. CBS Radio was very big also. And then later on, soon after that, the American Broadcasting Company, ABC, would also launch the television network. Now, as I had mentioned in one of the previous chapters, you know, when television comes on, of course, everybody wants to be visually entertained, but where are you going to get the talent? And they had to go around finding talent, looking for talent, everything else. Well, radio was a good place to find talent. also, in the movies, if somebody was just a B-movie star, because a lot of big movie stars, they're like, I'm not going to go on that little small screen. Because a lot of early televisions had only like a 4, 5, 6-inch screen, a 10-inch screen at the most. So they're like, I'm a star of the big screen, not the small screen. But yeah, you would have to get, and one comedian in 1948 for NBC, the variety show was what really launched television. The way to go ahead and get everyone watching television is to get something that would have a little bit of something for everybody. Typically, they were 90 minutes long, the variety show. And you'd have some comedy, you'd have some music, you'd have sketch comedy. You might have a little news item where maybe you interview somebody like a general, or later on, when we got into the space race in the 60s, astronauts were typically favored guest on the variety show. And you would try to get a little bit of everything for everybody. But in 1948, soon after NBC, the television network launched, one guy in particular starts hosting the Texaco Star Theater on NBC. And television would forever be changed.
We work from Maine to Mexico. There's nothing like this Mexico of ours.
By the way, you see, didn't take long for television to realize we sell advertising to help fund television. The Texaco Star Theater.
Tomorrow we'll be servicing your cars. I wipe the pipe, I pump the gas, I rub the hub, I scrub the glass, I touch the clutch, I mop the top, I poke the choke, I sell the pop, I clear the gear, I pump the knock, I jack the back, I set the clock. So join the ranks of those who know and fill your tank with Texaco. Sky Chief, fill up with Sky Chief, and you will smile at the pile of new miles you will add. Fire Chief, fill up with Fire Chief, you'll find that Texaco's the finest friend your car has ever had. And now, ladies and gentlemen, introducing America's number one television star, your June bride, Mildred Searle!
Now, this is something that Milton Berle was very famous for. It was dressing in drag, and he'd come out, and of course, it would be hilarious.
Have you heard? I married an elephant.
All right. He, of course, would do a monologue, introduce his guests. Milton Berle, as the star of the Texaco Star Theater, would become America's first television superstar. He would literally sell televisions because people would want to come every Monday night at 9 o'clock. They had to see his show. And it's interesting because he is referred to not only as Uncle Milty, but he's also always referred to as Mr. Television. Here's the reason why. In 1948, when his show first premiered, there were only 50,000 television sets in all of America. Think about that. 50,000. There might be 50,000 television sets just in my town. But think about it. 50,000 television sets just in America. By 1950, 2 years later, there were over 500,000 television sets. And a lot of that is attributed to people wanting to watch Milton Berle. Now, in the early days, if somebody got a television on your street, if you were a good neighbor, you would go to their house and watch TV. But you know what? After a while, you want to watch it in your own home. And also because of something else. A huge cultural phenomenon in this country helped television. This is probably, I had said with the Beatles, and when the Beatles arrived here less than 3 months after President Kennedy's assassination, it was probably one of the greatest moments of perfect timing. Well, so was television. Because television arrives in 1948 to give us the option of being able to be visually entertained at home. We don't have to leave now. We don't have to get up and go to a movie theater every, 3 or 4 nights a week. We can stay at home and be visually entertained. And this was helpful because what was that cultural phenomenon in America that helped to sell televisions? None other than the baby boom. Remember, World War II ends in 1945. Soon afterwards, our troops start to come home. Well, Rosie the Riveter's been working 7 days a week, 10-hour day shifts. All right? The war's now over. My guy comes home. Put a ring on my finger. Get me a house. Let's go. And that's what happened. So when the troops were coming home, Rosie gave up a Riveter, said, I want to be married, have a family, get it done. Guys had to. They had no choice. And of course, then came the babies. And that's why it's called the baby boom. Matter of fact, my mother, born in March of 1947. My grandfather was an Army corpsman who actually did land at D-Day at Omaha Beach as a corpsman and trudged through France, and even he went through Italy before he got taken out of Italy to go to France for D-Day. And, you know, there's my mother right there. He came back, married my grandmother. My mother's born in March of 1947. One of the first of the baby boom babies. So have you ever tried to take a baby to a movie theater? Have you tried to take two babies to a movie theater? Because my Uncle Donald was born in 1949. Not an easy thing to do, but if you could be visually entertained at home, now televisions became huge. 1948, 50,000 TV sets in America. 1950, 500,000. The baby boom and Uncle Milty. Well, now everybody else also wanted to try this variety show thing because it seemed to work very well for NBC. So CBS tries it. Okay. Now they call it Toast of the Town, their show. And they tried out different hosts and then they settled on this one host. He was a guy, he was a gossip columnist for the New York Daily News. So he had connections to the stars. The problem was he was very stiff. He wasn't very entertaining. As a matter of fact, after 2 months of him hosting CBS's Toast of the Town, the sponsor, the Emerson Radio and Television Company, pulled out. They said, you're going to keep this guy in. We can't stand him. We hate him as the host. He's dull. He's lifeless. We're done. So it looked like Toast of the Town, CBS's equivalent to the Texaco Star Theater, was going to die out. But suddenly here comes William Ford III of the Ford Motor Company. He came in and said, you know, I just heard what Emerson did. You know, big companies kind of hear what each other's doing. He says, you know what? I really like this guy, and I like Toast of the Town. So now why don't we let the Ford Lincoln Mercury dealers become the sponsor of Toast of the Town, which they did, and would continue until the show went off the air in 1971, 23 years later. Now, Toast of the Town became a big hit, especially soon afterwards. They named the show after the host. And that, of course, was one of the most famous television shows of all time, The Ed Sullivan Show.
Now, in introducing the Peoples again, may I point out that they'll be on our show, as I told our audience, for the next two Sundays. Next Sunday from the Deauville Hotel in the Miami Beach Show, starring Hollywood's exciting Mitzi Gaynor. But ladies and gentlemen, once again...
The Ed Sullivan Show, which introduced America to the Beatles. Just great stuff. Just great stuff. Now, there was also another network. Now, today we have four networks. We have eight of these are broadcast networks. ABC, NBC, CBS, and Fox. If we're on our TV dials, that's Channel 2 is CBS, Channel 4 is NBC, Channel 7 is ABC, and Channel 5 is Fox. But in 1950, some rich guy comes along and says, I want to have my own television network. His name was Alan Dumont. And for a very short period of time, he operates what's called the Dumont Television Network. Now, this was going to be tough because remember, I've told you how television is a very expensive thing to do. A lot of markets only have, at the most, three TV stations. Now, if you become an affiliate of a TV network, okay, and there's only ABC, NBC, and CBS, how are you going to get another affiliate if there's no TV station there? So it was very difficult for Dumont to go ahead and do that. But he was going to try his best. Now, he was going to follow along the lead of NBC and CBS and go with a variety show. So in 1950, he premieres what's called Cavalcade of Stars. And he finds some bright young comedian to be his host. And not only was he a bright young comedian, he was the great one. Hold on. I got to go back to the beginning. There we go. Of course, very old television has very bad quality. Known as the Great One, Jackie Gleason.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I feel wonderful tonight. I was playing golf all afternoon. I played with my dentist. Every time he came to a hole, he said, "Open wider, please." I was hacking away at the ball. I missed about seven times. Dirt was flying all around. There were two grasshoppers sitting there, and one said to the other, "Let's get on the ball before we get killed."
All right, that joke didn't exactly go well, but... So Jackie Gleason starts hosting Cavalcade of Stars, sponsored by the Druggists of America. That's who these people were who were singing. And it immediately becomes a big hit. Even though Dumont did not have nearly as many affiliates around the country as ABC, NBC, or CBS. And of course, he would bring all these characters. He had Joe the Bartender. He had Reginald Van Gleason. These are all these sketch comedies that he would do, characters that he created. And then he also created this one guy, this happy-go-lucky bus driver from Brooklyn by the name of Ralph Cramden. And they would call that the Honeymooners. And this went on for over 2.5 years. It was a big hit. Well, finally, William S. Paley of CBS approaches Gleason. And in 1952, he makes him an offer to take him away from the Dumont Television Network. "I'll give you $8,000 a week." Now, that was 1952, people. And I don't know about you, but if in 2021 somebody offered me $8,000 a week, you ain't getting a video next week. I mean, that's still a lot of money now. Think about what $8,000 a week was when 1952, when a gallon of gasoline was, what, 30 cents? When a loaf of bread was 5 cents? I mean, this was huge. So, of course, he can't ignore it. Dumont could not match that. He could not match it. So Gleason goes over to CBS to do his show, brings all his characters with him. And, unfortunately, the Dumont Network was doomed. That was their biggest star. Dumont couldn't keep it up, and then in 1958, the Dumont Network went dark. And we wouldn't see a fourth network until Fox in 1986. So now, Gleason goes ahead, does a show at CBS, and decides, after the 1954-1955 TV season, "I don't want to do the whole variety show anymore. I'm just going to do this one bit. And we'll do a sitcom for a season, one season, 39 episodes. So this show with one season and 39 episodes, and yet it's still considered one of the best, if not the best, sitcom of all time.
give me a heart attack or something.
Well, Norton, how do I look?
Steve's fine. I don't know how you're going to do with these barred clubs, but in that barred outfit, you are divine.
Thank you, Norton. Well, did you bring something down we can use for a ball?
Oh, yeah. I got this here pincushion. That's good enough for the
thumb. Perfect. Let me have it.
I wish I had a stand to put it
on. Let me have it.
I have... Ow!
What's the matter with you? There's pins in it.
What'd you expect to find in a pincushion? Chicken noodles?
Take the pins out.
He loves me. He loves me.
Will you stop with that?
Come on, Norton. I only got 2 days to learn how to play golf.
Wait a minute. I want to get the door. Wait till I shut the door. All right, look out.
Wrong with the club. It's the way you swing at the ball. You just don't swing at it ordinary. Like, you gotta do it scientific, like it says here in the book. Let me read it.
No time to do it by the book. I only got 2 days.
Go ahead. What's it say in the book?
Now you're getting smart. To Emily, who thrice inspired me to write this. The golf swing. First, step up. Plant your feet firmly on the ground and address the ball.
Wait a minute. What do they mean by address the ball?
How should I know? That's what it says here.
Well, read a little further. Maybe it explains.
That's all it says. Address the ball. Wait a minute. I think I know what it means there. Here, give me a shot. Step up. Plant your feet firmly. Hello, ball.
Oh, my goodness. One season, 39 episodes, and yet still, here in New York City on Channel 11, you'll still see it every weeknight. Or you might find your grandfather on a holiday, maybe New Year's Day or something like that. If he's not watching football, he might be in another room watching a Honeymooners marathon on Channel 11. It is still iconic and one of the great shows of all time. And speaking of sitcoms, sitcoms also in early television would be huge. And none other than this show. As in 1951, this show would take over for Milton Berle as the most watched show on television.
All right, girls, now this is your last chance. If one piece of candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped, you're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Okay.
This, of course, the I Love Lucy show, which again, it premiered in 1951 and would become the number one rated television show in America. Now, one of the interesting things is a couple of things happen here that made television history. Number one, it was the first television show that was produced by a woman. Lucy Ball, Lucille Ball, that is. Now, her husband also was part of the production team. That was Desi Arnaz, and that's why their production company was called Desi Lou Productions. But also, this was the first television show, especially sitcom, to actually film it first and then edit it before it went on to broadcast. See, up to this point, those first 3 years, 48, 49, 50, 51, you were on the air live. So if it was the variety show or anything, it was live. You know, there wasn't anything that was like filmed and then put together, edited. Maybe some of the Westerns that were coming on would do that, but this was the first sitcom that actually did that. And of course, you want the perfect product to get out there, especially if a prop is falling off the wall or something like that. Now, speaking of, I'd mention Westerns early on, from about 1948 to 1971. Westerns are the most popular type of show on television. And there were Westerns everywhere. I mean, from shows called Bonanza to probably the big one, Gunsmoke, which was on the air for 20 years, from 1955 to 1975. Have Gun Will Travel, Maverick. I mean, your grandfather right now might be watching one of the Western channels on cable TV. As those things go, there's a couple of them out there. And here's the opening for one of the first Western shows to become very popular on television. Anybody recognize that young man in his first ever acting role? That young man is Clint Eastwood. And that, of course, the TV show Rawhide, one of the many, many Westerns that would just incorporate television in its early days. Now, there are a lot of other things. I don't want to go too long here today. Television news, of course, was very big. And I don't want to... seem to have a little problems here. I'm going to try and fix my problem here. Uh-oh. Uh-oh, what did I do? I'll get it in a second here. We can just go back. There we go. All right. Nope, we don't need to watch that again. There we go. Nope. My first time doing something on the computer and transferring it to the... Okay, I got big problems here, so I'm trying to go back here. Let me X out of this. There we go. I'm trying to go down. Ah, there we go. Okay. I want to end today's by talking about one of the great innovators. And let's be honest, if you're a great innovator, you also hire great innovators. And at NBC, of course, David Sarnoff, NBC TV taking off thanks to Milton Berle and other TV shows. So he would appoint somebody as president of NBC. This is the guy who's going to run the television network. He's got two radio networks that are making him buku bucks. He's got other things he's involved with. RCA is, of course, now making television sets and making buku bucks. And now he's got the NBC TV network. And he goes ahead and appoints a guy by the name of Pat Weaver. Now, Pat Weaver, besides helping to develop the Milton Berle Show and other programs that would be hugely successful in the early days of television, decides that at each part of the day, there needed to be something that was news but lighthearted. That as people were going to bed, okay, maybe a great little interview show. So he calls it The Tonight Show. And this was in 1951. Same year, he also creates a show that would be news but also be lighthearted when you first woke up in the morning. He would call that The Today Show. So in the morning you had The Today Show. Before you went to bed, you had The Tonight Show. I'd say pretty catchy, pretty smart, pretty simple. And yet to this day, 2021, those two are the standards for that. And the networks still make a lot, not just the networks, but cable television makes a lot of money off of late night TV or the morning shows. The Today Show, CBS This Morning, Good Morning America. Of course, at night, you've got Kimmel, you've got Colbert, you've got, what's his name on Comedy Central? It's Conan O'Brien over on TBS. So it's still a big deal. As a matter of fact, he also did something pretty cool, too, is one of his legacies. This is Sigourney Weaver, Academy Award-winning actress. Some of you may recognize her. This is her hosting SNL. I think it was after she did Avatar. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and skip about 2 minutes in. Here we go.
After the show.
It's Kristen Wiig.
She seems nice. You know, there really is nothing to be scared of. I practically grew up in this building. It's true. When I was a kid, my dad, Pat Weaver, was president of NBC. I'm not kidding. Now, I used to run around these halls. Look, here's a picture of him from that time with me and my mom. I'm not wearing a bra in that picture either.
Just a great legacy that Pat Weaver left with television, The Tonight Show and The Today Show. And some of the things he did in primetime were really good, too. All right, we're going to stop right there. I'll have the next video for you on Friday as we continue talking about the history of television. All right, I hope this worked out for you guys, and we'll see you on Friday.